Alaska is not a place for the weak of heart. It's a place where only the strong survive. The ones who truly believe and understand how powerful we can be as one. The seawolf is a creature that it is said, if you hear its howl, it will bring you great luck and prosperity. For 40 years, we were lucky enough to hear its great howl far and wide. A new day has now dawned. New challenges lie ahead. We'll face these challenges together as one. One city, one team, one university. Now join me in welcoming the new era of Seawolf hockey.
And welcome back to the Seawolf Sport Complex. Pleased to be joined now by UAA head coach Matt Shasby ahead of tonight's Game 4 of the Alaska Airlines Governor's Cup Series with Alaska Fairbanks. Matt, last night, a 4-0 loss, but if looking at the game from a fan's point of view like I do, if you throw the first period out, really the game 5-on-5 was extremely tight last night. It was just that first period where they kind of got off to where they started last week.
Yeah, it was a moment where it was a delayed penalty. They scored on it, and then they scored immediately after on the power play, and that popped the game open to 2-0. It's tough to recover from, especially in a team like ourselves that, we're averaging less than 2 goals per game. And so when you have a 2-minute window where you give up two, it's going to be tough to recover from. But, our guys just keep playing regardless, and they're going to continue to compete. And hopefully tonight we can avoid any lapses like that and be able to – really we just need to get a lead, and I think we can build on that.
Second period, the guys came out with a little bit of fire under their behinds, and you could really see it in the way they played, the way they forechecked. They really tilted the ice, maybe not necessarily in their favor, but it certainly evened out.
Yeah, it did. It's just, again, maintaining and playing at a certain pace, and our guys committing and being willing to compete every shift. It makes all the difference in the world, and really just playing with a bit more confidence. Mm-hmm. And you saw that in the second, and the third was just, they played a good system where it was, tough to get any more scoring chances. But, again, they got a special teams goal at the very end of a power play at the start of the third period that really kind of put the game out of reach, knowing that we're just not generating much. But, I was happy with the effort from beginning to end. We just have to avoid, and we just, at the end of the day, it's special teams. We gotta stop theirs, and we gotta start putting pucks in the net.
Well, you led me right into where I was going to go next, special teams. Mm-hmm. Last night, Fairbanks goes 2-for-2 on the power play. Seawolves 0-for-6. So, obviously, like you said, you can draw a lot just from that.
Yeah. I mean, it's been our Achilles heel all year. Hopefully tonight we get a bounce here and there, and that's what it's going to take. It's just increasing our shot volume, getting pucks to the net, and hopefully something bounces off somebody and goes in. We're not generating anything pretty, and that's going to kind of be our mentality, is just funnel pucks to the net, get bodies to the net, and hopefully get a couple ugly ones tonight.
How much of power play woes have to do with still trying to get these guys to gel? You haven't had the team together for a couple of years, and we've talked about it, obviously, quite a bit, but how much is something like a power play affected by that? Is it, guys still trying to figure out where each other is going to be at?
At this level, the quality of play is so high that we have guys that maybe haven't been on a power play since junior hockey. Mm-hmm. All of our transfers, they weren't on power plays where they were playing, right? And so it's going to take guys developing those skill sets again, developing that comfort of running a power play, playing certain positions on the power play. Even with guys that this is what they do, it's still difficult. And so we're still trying to find pieces. We're still trying to teach certain guys how to execute special teams. And, that is going to take time. And maybe, at this point in the season, maybe we don't have the personnel to have a power play that's over 10%. So now we have to kind of regroup and figure out what we can accomplish with the personnel that we have and try and be as successful as we can with them.
One thing, too, with the Fairbanks penalty kill, it seems to from the fans' point of view, again, they do a really nice job of taking away time, taking away space. That means your guys have to speed things up a lot in their mind. And
right. Yeah, I mean, so they're putting us in positions to have to make very high-skilled plays, low-percentage plays, and they're just hyper-aggressive. And if you don't have the stick skills and the ability to whether it's a short saucer passes over sticks that are collapsing on you or making three consecutive passes, which we're not able to string together at this point, you know, that's the way to kill against it, is to force them to have to make high skill plays, or which is us. So hopefully tonight we were able to implement some things and hopefully the puck finds the back of the net and it'll give us a big boost.
One last thing, Joey Lamoureux last night looked pretty good. He made some pretty good saves, kept the guys in it, especially early on. Who's in the pipes tonight?
Nolan Kent will play tonight. Just hoping he can give us a nice, consistent, solid effort and stop what he's supposed to, and then maybe steal us a couple as well. And hopefully we can give him some run support here and put some in the back of the net.
Matt, thanks for the time. Good luck tonight against the Nanooks.
Thanks, David.
Matt Chasby joining me here right before our game number four of the Alaska Airlines Governor's Cup Series. We'll be back with Seawolf Hockey right after this.
We've all been there. It's senior year and you have nothing but questions. Sometimes you just can't stop asking yourself, what's next? With over 100 degree and certificate programs to help you build a bright future, student activities and clubs to find your community, financial aid opportunities and resources to help you succeed, the University of Alaska Anchorage has you covered. What's next? UAA is what's next. Apply today.
This is it. The moment you've dreamed of, worked for, sacrificed for. This is the moment you go from seeking a degree to being sought after. Top companies all across Alaska are looking for University of Alaska Anchorage grads to power their businesses into the future because they know UAA grads are smart, qualified, capable, and backed by a strong, supportive community. Apply today and seize the moment.
Good evening. This is UAA Seawolves Hockey coming to you live from the Seawolf Sports Complex on the campus of the University of Alaska Anchorage. I'm David Tuttle, joined as always by Matt Nevila, and it's game four of the 2022-23 Alaska Airlines Governor's Cup Series. Matt, three-game hole that the Seawolves have dug themselves into. How do they dig out?
Well, the way that Matt Shasky talked about last night, today is a new day, and Seawolves have been looking for a new day for quite a while. But each day is an opportunity for this team, as we have mentioned many a time. Everything about it is new. New day, new night. Anything could happen. You saw what's happened in the NFL earlier today.
Oh, my goodness.
Greatest comeback of all time.
Yep.
Maybe the Seawolves have a little bit of that love coming their way tonight as well.
Yeah, it's definitely something to point out and say, hey, we're not out of this yet. We're down 33-0 at halftime, but, you know, we're in the game. Why not?
You know, and we touched on again last night, that, you know, there's a big part of this. These guys might not necessarily know this rivalry frontwards and backwards, but the last thing they want to see them do is skate around with a trophy on in their barn.
Exactly.
You know, and there's always that part of it. So whatever they can bring to the table a little bit differently tonight should be a welcome sight for UAA.
In the goals tonight for each team, Matt Radomski in the net again for UAF. 6'2", 195-pound senior, picked up the shutout last night. And on the season, he's 8'7", 2". For UAA, Nolan Kent, grad transfer from Northern Michigan, 5'9", 176-pounder from Chestermere, Alberta. 1-5 on the season, .914 save percentage, and a .313 goals against average. So, you know, a couple of changes in both lineups. But, yeah, you know, the way last night's game ended, starting to really get chippy, Carson Kosova and Garrett Pike. Honestly, I expect a lot more of that tonight, considering four games in a row against the same team. Familiarity breeds contempt.
Well, the teams have definitely figured out or had enough time with each other to know what they like and dislike about one another. So see if that comes to fruition or not.
So we are ready to go and underway off the initial draw. Garrett Pike controls for Fairbanks. Tries to go cross ice with it. It hits skates. And James Darby, flips that one back into the neutral zone. TJ Lloyd gathers in for the Seawolves. He's chased back behind his own net by Jared White. White still hounding him all the way up the half wall. And the Seawolves force a turnover on that half wall. UAF, gets that one back. And it's Harrison Israel's up the left wing boards across the Seawolf blue line. Nope. Shot hit skates in front. Tough rebound, but not able to control it was Johnny Sorensen. Puck in that left wing corner. Now Sorensen has it back on his tape. And the Seawolves
working hard to get it off his tape. Matt Johnson and Israel's high up on that far half wall. Puck finally on the stick of Carson Kosabud behind his own net as both teams complete changes. Puck sent up the wall, broken up, and right back into the zone went the Nanooks. Kosabud circles his net, and he'll try to come out once again. In doing so is Brandon LaJoy, one of the new faces into the lineup tonight, replacing Connor Cole. Hit put on behind the net by LaJoy. Nanooks, though, still in possession. They're able to work it out to the neutral zone. Dylan Finley dumps the puck back in, but the Seawolves had not touched up yet. And we have our first offside whistle of the game. 18:37 to go in period number one. We have no score. Faceoff just outside of the Nanooks zone in front of the penalty boxes. Max Helgeson pulls that one back. Gilson goes cross ice, and then the puck is fired into the net or into the zone. We hope it gets fired into the net at some point. Nanooks able to get the puck free back into the neutral zone. UAA, though, turns it right back in off the stick of William Gilson. Puck rims around behind the net, back out to the neutral zone. And we've got a whistle and a high stick called. And it's not a penalty, just the puck was played by a high stick, so the faceoff will come back deep into the Nanooks zone. 18:11 left in period number one. Jamie Collins in to take the draw for the Seawolves against Colin Doyle. And it's shipped back out to the neutral zone by the Nanooks. Carrying it ahead is Simon Falk. He had a goal and an assist last night in the first period. Nanooks shot wide of the net off the stick of Colin Doyle. Rebound gathered in by Collins. He's trying to escape the forecheck of Doyle. Puck kept alive momentarily by Millamook, and it's up the half wall. Gomez waited a little bit too long. He needed to attack that puck as opposed to waiting for it to come to him. And Garrett Pike managed to rip it away. UAA, though, back through the neutral zone with Gomez. Seawolves in offside. They will tag up and go for a change, as do the Nanooks. TJ Lloyd up through the neutral zone with speed up the left wing wall. Lloyd backhands one towards the net, but wide. Jared White now picks it up for the Seawolves as he carries across the center stripe and dumps it in to the Nanook end. Puck sent up the half wall and a cross ice feed to Johnny Sorensen. Tried to spring Harrison Israels. The puck was too far out in front of him, though, and Nolan Kent able to play that into the corner. Almquist on the half wall throws it back into the corner. Now it's right back up on the half wall. Harrison Israels takes a couple of hits for his efforts, but UAA is going to be able to get the puck at least out to the neutral zone. Right back in with it is Johnny Sorensen, just backhanding that one deep into the Seawolf end, forcing UAA to chase once again. Osborne gives off to Kosabud, and Kosabud up the wall to White. Jared White had it deflect off his stick, rolls back into the possession of the Nanooks. Now gathering it in once again, this time Marcus Comals. He goes up and
right into
over
the
wall.
Bench.
And that's not a way to make friends with your teammates, shooting it into your own bench. We'll bring a faceoff back to the Nanooks zone. 16:22 to go in period number one.
Entering the rink tonight, ran into Jeremy Millamook, the former UAA defensive great and nemesis of the Idaho Steelheads for the Alaska Aces back in the day. His son Connor, a freshman, or excuse me, a sophomore on UAF right now, number 32.
Yeah, not in the lineup last night, but he is, he's back in there tonight. Seawolf shot blocked away, and the Nanooks will come ahead. Kyle Gaffney sending it into the Seawolf zone. Getting a hard right into the boards was Helgeson from Brady Risk, and UAA flips that one back out through the neutral zone. They can't gather it in, though. Fairbanks able to chip it right back out. Now it's Brett Bamber. Bamber trying to get away from Anton Rubstov, able to get it ahead to Belitsky off his stick and deep into the Nanooks zone. Trying to play that one ahead was Carl Falk, and instead it comes right back out to the Seawolves at the blue line. Pass across from Hamlin. He takes a return feed now at the top of the right circle. Shot towards Radomski, and He will glove that one easily. Some hurt feelings as Jamie Collins took an extra swipe at the end.
Some of the unpleasantries you were talking about already on display here.
Yeah, last night at the end of the game, it was Carson Kozabud drawing the ire of the Nanooks for getting a little too close to Radomski.
Radomski especially didn't like that when Connor Mara came through the blue paint area there at the end of the play.
Good start for the Seawolves tonight thus far through the first almost 5 minutes. Shot on Radomski. He goes ahead and gloves that. We'll have another faceoff off to his left. Now Kanash pulls the faceoff over to the wing. Nanooks come away with the puck, at least momentarily. Simon, or make that Carl Falk, puts the hit on to free it up. Now coming back the other way, Johnny Sorensen. And that one is sent out of the zone. It'll roll all the way, or most of the way down to the Seawolves zone. Icing was waved off, and then Derek Hamlin will ice the puck coming back the other way. So the Seawolves will have a faceoff deep in their own end. 15:08 left in our first period. And off the draw, puck is down, and Derek Hamlin pulls it out of the scrum for the Seawolves. He sends it up the wall. Brandon LaJoy gets helped into his own bench after deflecting the puck out through the neutral zone. LaJoy now back on the ice. I always find it's a lot nicer to get dumped into your own bench than it is to the opposition's bench.
Gonna find a little more assistance there,
yes,
for sure.
Yes. Here comes Matt Suey right back in the left wing side. Leaves a pass off for Garrett Pike. Pike shot sticked away by Nolan Kent. Matsui right back to it, back to the point. Pike this time, the slap shot blockered away by Kent. Hamlin sends it up the half wall to Gomez as Gomez is able to get the puck out to the neutral zone, and the Seawolves dump it all the way down the ice. Radomski out of his net to hold it up for Garrett Pike. Pike harassed by Gomez behind his own net, but the Nanooks able to get it up out to the neutral zone where James Darby will turn it back the other way momentarily for the Seawolves as Millimook comes in and puts Jamie Collins on his backside and then backhands the puck into the Seawolf net. Or, I'm sorry, Seawolf end. Shot towards the Seawolf net that time. Nolan Kent made a couple of saves on Colin Doyle, who was on the doorstep. Puck comes free right out in front. Saved by Kent. Yeah. Loose puck still bouncing around down there, and it's finally tracked down and sent up and out of the zone by James Darby. Dangerous opportunity there for the Nanooks. McManus gets it deep into the Seawolf end, puts a hit on Kozabud. Kozabud, though, able to get the puck ahead. And that was Darby throwing a pass off of Jamie Collins. Pass across the blue paint. Nolan Kent was out of the crease area. He still is. The Nanooks, though, not able to find a shooting lane. And the Seawolves dodge a bullet right there. Cross-ice pass, McManus to Colmoles. His shot blocked up high. And Jared White hands off to Caleb Height. Walks in, shot wide of the net. We've got a penalty coming up. This is going to be on Fairbanks. And UAA will get their first power play opportunity of the night. And let's take a break. We'll be back. 13:04 left in the first period. We have no score.
This is fascinating. If the music comes on, I cannot hear anything. I can get thrown out immediately, which is fine.
Yeah. And we are back at the Seawolf Sport Complex on the campus of the University of Alaska Anchorage. Marcus Comels, 2 minutes in the box. Here's another look at that hit that TJ Lloyd put on Brandon LaJoy, helping him make an early line change. Off the draw, the Nanooks control, and they will rip that one all the way down the ice. Interference is the call on Comels. Brett Bamber now with it behind his own net, leaves off for Derek Hamlin. Hamlin pass up through the middle of the ice, deflects off Max Helgeson's stick, goes all the way down.
Nice control job from Helgeson right there in the right-hand corner.
Helgeson with the puck on that half wall, goes down low with it, takes a return feed. Top of the right circle, shot saved by Radomski. Rebound pops out, and able to keep it alive was Hamlin momentarily. Then he fanned on a pass attempt, and he's able to keep the puck away from Garrett Pike. Icing's going to get waved off, though. Good hustle there by Connor Merritt to win that race and keep the Seawolves alive in the Nanook zone. Bamber with it up the left wing board, slowly making his way down, looking for some space. Tries to go back to Merritt with it. That's broken up and backhanded all the way down the ice, and we're down to 43 seconds to go.
No dice on the Seawolf power play. No dice on that opportunity, but that's the kind of play that UA did not make at all last night, any kind of lucky bouncer or moment, so that has to bode well for UA.
Dylan Finley with it on his stick as he backpedals in his own end. Down to 25 seconds to go on the Seawolf man advantage. Almquist gives up to Will Gilson across the Nanook blue line. Overskating that one down there was Matt Johnson. Seawolves keep it alive. Dylan Finley still with it on his tape, goes to Jared White. Behind the net, back to Almquist at the right circle. Shot goes up high, Gilson's shot deflected and up into the netting. We'll have a faceoff once again in the Nanook zone. 5 seconds to go on the Seawolf power play, their first of the night. 11:09 to play in period number one. Shots on goal reads 4-3 right now in favor of the Nanooks. And they have definitely had the better opportunities so far in this first period. Off the draw, Seawolves control. Gilson takes the shot, hits traffic on the way through. And that's going to do it for the man advantage. Cross ice pass deflected high over everybody into the glass. Caleb Height finally furthers that along, looking for Matt Johnson. Big hit put on by Jared White. Seawolves trying to pull that one free. Shot comes in from the point, right into the shin pads, though, of Johnny Sorensen. Fairbanks does do a really nice job of blocking shots. We've got a penalty coming up. That's going to be on the Nanooks once again. And see what they decide there. It's going to be Bergmanis.
Elbowing penalty. Hey, one thing, I don't know whether it's a concerted effort or not, that I like seeing from the Seawolf blue liners on a power play on this extended offensive, they're throwing it at the net. Even if they got people in no lane, unlike last night where maybe there was a little too much passing on the perimeter, again, just start firing things that way and hope for good things to happen.
Absolutely, absolutely. It doesn't matter how the puck goes in the net, how many bodies it has to bounce off of. They all count the same. So Seawolf, second consecutive power play as Bergmanis goes 2 minutes for an elbow. And the power play is over just like
UA.
That.
The slash.
Well,
so much for that. Carter Berlitsky coming to the penalty box
over
for a slash right off the draw.
So we'll skate 4-on-4 for the next minute 54. And then Fairbanks will get an abbreviated 6-second power play. Face off to the left of the Seawolf net. And that draw is pulled back by the Nanooks. TJ Lloyd has to chase that one down in the neutral zone as it carried all the way out of the Seawolf zone. Gaffney cross ice to TJ Lloyd. Lloyd just staying onside right there was Gaffney, or excuse me, Brady Risk. And that puck rolls in on Nolan Kent, who will slap a glove on it. Another light night in college hockey. We'll go through the scoreboard here in just a little bit. Off the drop, up to Jared White. He's trying to get away from Carl Falk, able to backhand that one out to the neutral zone. Breaking that one up there was Marcus Kobels. Puck sent deeper into the Seawolf zone, trying to get away from the checking is White. And UAA able to force that one out to the neutral zone, but no further as UAF will transition right back into the zone. Loose puck just poked off the stick. Nicely done by the Nanooks. That was Peyton Matsui to keep that away from Jared White. And right back up with it now is Garrett Pike up the left wing side. Pike still carries. Shot blockered aside by Nolan Kent. Looked like it may have been going wide anyways. However, you can't be too sure on that. Puck back into the Nanook zone. Chance here coming up for the Seawolf. Shot over the net by Carson Kozabud. And the Nanooks right back the other way. It's Pike into the Seawolf zone. Tries to center. That's into some skates. And UAA able to force that one just back out to the neutral zone. Kozabud gets it ahead to Caleb Height. He's going to pull it back and slow things down a little bit. We're down to 25 seconds left on the 4-on-4. 8:57 left in our first period. We have no score. Chance now coming up the other way for the Nanooks. A.J. McCauley carrying up the left wing side. Shot saved by Kent off the glove. Didn't catch it cleanly, but he made enough of a rebound, or made enough distance on the rebound, I should say, to keep it relatively safe. Back to the neutral zone we go. Backpedaling in his own end is Gilson. And we are into the 6-second Fairbanks power play, which is now over. And the puck is sent all the way down the ice. Puck kept alive in the Nanook zone by UAA. Merritt back to the point. Not able to keep that one in was Osborne. He sends it in, but the Seawolves are offside. They tag up. And now it's McCauley on the left wing side. He runs into traffic in the form of Max Helgeson. And that puck comes free. Nanook's able to pick it up by Millima. Carries into his own zone to try and move up one more time. That one's sent all the way down the ice. It is deflected. Icing is waved off. Darby trying to get to that. He's harassed by Colin Doyle. Millimuck down there as well for the Nanooks. Back to the point to Bergmanis. Put it into the skates of Colin Doyle. He couldn't find it. Gets a little bit of help from his friends. Puck set deep into the corner. Bergmanis chasing it down for the Nanooks. James Darby cuts him off. And Darby and Doyle digging it out. It finally comes free. Back to the point it goes to Bergmanis. Bergmanis gets it back to Doyle. Takes a return feed. Shot. And there glove save. Nicely done by Nolan Kent. He had some traffic in front of him. He was able to find that one through that maze. And he will melt that down. And we'll take, well, we'll get a whistle. I thought we were going to take a media timeout. But we're down to 7:08 left in our first period. We have no score.
Looks like Nolan Kent's talking to the official about some potential goaltender interference going on. A lengthy discussion. Faceoff will be to Nolan Kent's right.
Jamie Collins will take the draw opposite Kyle Gaffney for the Nanooks. Those two tie up. Brady Risk pulls the faceoff away. His shot off of Caleb Height. And now it's out to the neutral zone. Gomez trying to chase that one down. Garrett Pike beats him to it. And now it's Rubstoff flipping it into the Seawolf zone. Britt Bamber gloves that down and sends it back out to the neutral zone. TJ Lloyd gathers for the Nanooks. Backpedaling in his own end. He's watched by Jamie Collins. Pass goes up the boards. Able to catch it momentarily but not keep it was Brady Risk, and now the Seawolves are right back in, or have it right back into the Nanooks zone. TJ Lloyd has it behind his net there. Nanooks up through the center ice area. Dylan Finley chases it down for the Seawolves, and he'll pull up behind his own net while the forwards change in front of him. Fairbanks takes this opportunity to change as well, and the puck is set all the way down the ice, deflected by Gomez. Brigmanis carries out from behind his own net, and hitting the center ice stripe is Johnny Sorensen. He gives a pass off to Brigmanis, walks in, shot saved by Kent. Nice job by Nolan Kent there to stand his ground and get a blocker on that attempt by Brigmanis. Great play by him. But we remain scoreless. Jared White now up through the neutral zone. He's cut off by Comels as the Nanooks get the puck out to the neutral zone. UAA, though, in possession. Max Osborne backpedaling, trying to get away from Sorensen. Cross ice to Kosabud. Kosabud can't connect on a pass, and now UAF right back into the zone. Two-on-one chance if they hurry. But fanning on the shot there is Sorensen. He picks up the trailer shot, hits a bunch of traffic in front of the net. That was A.J. McCauley with that opportunity. Another shot comes through. That one made it into Kent, and he got that one with the right pad. Puck now behind the Seawolf net, trying to pull it free is Nielsen. Trying to work free from Kosabud. Almquist steps in to help him out. Puck turned towards the front of the net. Doesn't connect cleanly with Chase Dubois. He goes back to the point, then takes a return feed and throws the puck into the corner. Almquist ties up a Nanooks skater down there. A turnover right in front. Bad turnover. Shot save made by Nolan Kent. He had to be ready for that, as that was just a bang-bang play. And UAA finally able to work that one down the ice. That got dangerous in a hurry. Both teams taking a chance to change. Jared White was tied up with one of the Nanooks right at the bench. That was, you heard a little bit of yelling from that. Let's take a break. 4:43 left in the period. No score. We'll be right back. UAF, the 2022-23 Alaska Airlines Governor's Cup Game 4. Brett Bamber gives off to Derek Hamlin. Hamlin will start that ahead. His pass deflected deep into the Nanooks zone. And Fairbanks will turn and come right back the other way. Puck rolls in on Nolan Kent. He steps out and fires that one ahead. Either hit somebody on the bench or hit the linesman, one of the two, but either way, it's whistled down for offside.
I don't know, David. About the last 6 or 7 minutes, we've seen more weird bounces and hops and just the puck acting funky to last us a season's worth here in a mini part of a period.
You know what, though? I will take the technical difficulties on the ice as opposed to up here.
I wonder if all that snow dissipated now and they're just it's frozen stiff because we're in sub-zero temperatures in good old Anchortown tonight.
Nothing like a ton of snow and -9 temperature.
Fairbanks penalty coming.
Puck dumped in by the Seawolves. Getting to it and touching it up is Marcus Comels. And at the 15:54 mark, UAA will get power play opportunity number 3. And I'm not sure what the call is yet. Anton Rubtsov going into the box. And it's going to be a rough.
So right off that draw, Rubtsov delivered a little how you doing to somebody.
So here UAA is on their third power play of the night. See if they can make something happen here. Right off the bat, though, the Nanooks able to chip that one out to center ice. Race for the puck. Just getting to it was Gilson ahead of Gaffney. And Gilson has it back, and the Seawolves will start ahead. Dylan Finley to Almquist, who's going to leave off for Matt Johnson. Johnson stick handles across the Nanook blue line. Runs into Brigmanis. Puck still deep in the Nanook end. Jared White shouldered off the puck, and the Nanooks will come right back through the neutral zone. Dumping it in is Harrison Israels. Nolan Kent out of his net to give off to Derek Hamlin. Ahead now, Jared White on the right wing wall. He runs into Garrett Pike, who fends him off neatly, and the Nanooks able to roll that one right back through the neutral zone. Dylan Finley forced all the way back behind his own net by Peyton Matsui. And Finley will start one more time up through the neutral zone come the Seawolves. Connor Merritt trying to work his way around TJ Lloyd. Lloyd, nice job of bodying him up, but it's centered. Carter Belitsky shot, save made by Radomski. Belitsky has it back on his tape. He leaves off looking for Connor Merritt. Merritt to Helgeson at the top of the right circle. Helgeson goes down low looking for Merritt. That didn't connect, but UAA still maintains control. Belitsky, Helgeson shot, saved by Radomski. UAA is pointing as though it may have gone in, but that was a really nice, quick setup play by the Seawolves and a quality scoring chance right there.
Really probably the first time they got inside the dot in that shooting kind of area where they're a legit shooting chance, or at least a respectable angle as opposed to low quality side of the net, goal line side. So again, a better period so far for UA, chipping away, hoping to cash in here at some point.
23 seconds to go on this Seawolf power play. Faceoff, one back to Hamlin, he carries ahead. Now he gives up to Helgeson in the right corner, trying to circle the net as Helgeson. He goes back up to the point. Pass across to Hamlin. He feeds it into Merritt. His shot missed the net, but keeping it alive is Bamber. 5 seconds left in the man advantage. Here's Helgeson trying to cut to the middle. Puck knocked off his stick. A pair of Seawolves down there, and neither one able to get a shot off. Shot towards the net. Pass broken up. Here comes UAA right back the other way. Nice play by Max Helgeson to pick the pocket of Anton Rubtsov, who's fresh out of the penalty box. Rubtsov now carries across the blue line. His shot off sticks goes high over the net. Rubtsov back to the point now. TJ Lloyd's shot goes wide. Bergmanis steps in to keep that one alive for the Nanooks. He blows a tire. It's going to give the Seawolves a chance to come ahead. Cross ice feed is dumped in by Brandon LaJoie. Around it goes on the half wall. Nanooks back in control. They circle their own net, Bergmanis does. And now it's Falk, Simon Falk leading the way. His shot high over everybody and goes into the netting. So we're gonna have a face-off back in the Seawolf zone. Not sure about that one. I think that one should come out to center ice. It didn't look like it was deflected at all. It looked like it went straight up into the netting. The officials are gonna talk about it. We're down to a minute 12 left in period number one, and we remain scoreless.
Whether Nolan Kent got a piece of that possibly before we're up in the netting.
Yeah, they're going to bring it outside. I think that's a good call. So faceoff right in front of the Seawolf bench. One back by the Nanooks. Shot on net right off the draw from center ice by TJ Lloyd. Garrett Pike stepping into Alex Gomez to keep that puck alive in the zone. Momentarily by the Nanooks. Gomez with it right back on his stick. He backhands it out. All the way down the ice it goes. TJ Lloyd out hustles Caleb Height to the puck as we're down to 50 seconds to play in this first period. Lloyd trying to get away from Height. He does. He gets it over to Pike. Back to Lloyd. Across the Seawolf blue line he comes. TJ Lloyd still carries it. Trying to get around Dylan Finley. Finley pokes the puck off his stick momentarily. Turning a shot towards the net was Matt Cothy. And back to the point it goes now, Garrett Pike. His shot through traffic, and it never made it to the net. It actually hit the traffic. Puck sent ahead, out of the zone. Here's Finley with 25 seconds left. He'll send that one deep into the Nanook end as the Seawolves change behind the play. Pike sends it off the back wall, and the Nanooks. Long pass attempt broken up. UAA right back into the zone with 10 seconds left. Here's Jared White. Back up to the point, it goes to Bamber. Tries to go across to Hamlin, that doesn't connect. And we are into the neutral zone and done with 20 minutes, no score. Through 20 minutes of play and shots on goal 10-5, but honestly, that was a really good first period if you're a UAA fan.
You say it was a little conservative bent there maybe from UAA in those last minute and a half, but given kind of the track record of late, why not? Let's just kind of bide our time, stay out of trouble more importantly.
Exactly.
And just kind of keep trying to build off of that, as we say often.
Yeah, and I think, you know, looking at that period, I think there's a lot to build off of. Obviously, special teams is still a question mark.
Yeah.
UAA 0-3 on the power play. Granted, one of those was only 6 seconds because of the penalty by Belitsky that wiped it out. But as a whole, I like that period for the Seawolves. And I think more than anything, they're not down going into
right,
the
room. Right, and they kind of took what there was. Like,
yeah.
As like we mentioned earlier, a lot of shots from the perimeter as opposed to passing around the perimeter as it did last evening. So, again, let's see if that bears any fruit here anytime soon.
I will say, I think they had more dangerous scoring chances in that first period than they may have had all of last
yeah.
night.
And we mentioned like being more in a legitimate shooting yeah. area as opposed to off to the side, or where there's not going to be a lot of damage done from those side angles to kind of be able to find some open ice or some open areas in those shooting lanes. So definitely a plus.
You can see a couple of highlights. Brandon LaJoy is not going to want to keep seeing that one. But it was a nice hit by TJ Lloyd. Quality chance here for Bergmanis. Nolan Kent reaching out the glove to snare that from the top of the circles. Here's UAA's best chance. Connor Merritt
yep.
able to pull it behind the net, find Max Helgeson untouched in front. And Helgeson, great opportunity.
Radomski is deep
though.
In the net on that play, which is also kind of unusual.
So that's where we're at right now. We're through 20. We're going to take a break. We'll be back here with more Alaska Airlines Governors Cup hockey in just a few moments. Welcome back to the Seawolf Sports Complex here on the campus of the University of Alaska Anchorage. Just got a chance to meet Joey Lamrew's father in the building tonight, and got to talk to him a little bit about what is it like to be a goalie parent at this age, since I know what it's like to be a goalie parent at 10U. It's nice to know what to expect. Anyways, stats from that first period look like this. No score, obviously. Shots on goal, Fairbanks with 10, Anchorage with 5. Penalties in that first period. UAF took 3 for 6 minutes, UAA 1 for 2 minutes. Power plays, UAF 0 for 1, UAA is 0 for 3. Saves in that first period, Matt Radomski with 5, Nolan Kent of the Seawolves with 10. So UAA did have the edge in faceoffs in that first period, winning 12 out of 18. So really curious to see what they come out with to start the second. Last night, the shots were similar in the first period. UAA, though, came out really hard in the second and really, really kind of tilted the ice back to even, not necessarily in their favor, but definitely even. And we'll see what kind of adjustments they came up with in the intermission tonight. So just wait for the teams to head back out on the ice right now as the ice crew finishes trying to squeegee up some standing water. While we're doing that, let's take a look at our out-of-town scores, all five of them. Ohio State tonight crushing Bowling Green 9-4. DU, Denver holds off Lindenwood 5-4 at the Magnus Arena. It was Michigan Tech 5-1 winners over Lake Superior State, and Ferris State 4-2 over St. Thomas. So a couple of weekend splits there in the CCHA. Coming up at our second intermission, I had a chance to talk earlier with Bruce Check, the radio voice for the Nanooks, and he's been doing this for 34 years.
And not only, he's also a great ambassador for high school sports here in Alaska. So during the football season, he'll take the time. Our late friend Dick Lobdell used to do this a lot back in the days when there wasn't a Twitter feed to go find scores on, but Bruce will do what he has to do to track down scores from all around the state, spread the word, which I know a lot of people appreciate. It's awful nice to see.
And you'll appreciate this. He just bought a house in Michigan, and he is going to be moving there.
Can't go wrong with that.
Yep. He's still planning on doing the games from home. And he's been calling the Nanook Road games from home. So good on him. Bruce, he's always been really helpful for me whenever I've come across him broadcasting here or in Fairbanks. And just a good guy.
No shortage of enthusiasm when it comes to Mr. Check, that's for sure.
No, you're absolutely right.
David, is this me or the team seem to be taking their time tonight?
They very much are.
First period seemed to be a little late. Now, here we go with this.
Yeah. Well, the officials also this time, this period took a lot of time to get out there. Maybe they wanted the ice crew to use the squeegee so they didn't have to. Also want to give a thanks out to Nanook goaltender Daniel Allen, who took a little bit of time out of his pregame prep to talk to my daughter about why she should stay playing goalie.
It was also nice to be visited by Mr. Lamro just a few seconds
ago.
He came up and said hi, introduced himself, and was thanking us for pulling these off each time we've been able to. So I told him we're doing the best we can.
That's all we can
do.
He goes,
that was great. I'm like, all right, I'll take that.
I'll take that anytime. he's in the house. Connor Merritt's parents are in the house this weekend as well. They all wanted to come out here and enjoy Snowpocalypse 22 and hockey. And off the draw, we are back underway. Puck trickles into the Seawolf zone. Nolan Kent, he comes out of his net to rip it around the boards. Puck gets tied up on that half wall, sent in deeper. Johnny Sorensen couldn't control it. He was knocked off the puck by Osborne. Back up to the point. It goes shot towards the net by Lloyd. Goes high and wide. Then a puck thrown across the top of the blue paint. TJ Lloyd sends it deeper into the net into the end for the Nanooks. And Jared White finally able to work it out into the neutral zone for the Seawolves. Garrett Pike going back to pick that one up, sends it around behind his own net. Pass ahead, didn't connect cleanly with Matt Cothy. But once again, the Nanooks right back into the Seawolf zone. Puck left off by Harrison Israels. Shot saved by Kent. Looked like he may have got his shoulder on that one, and that one's going to go all the way down the ice. That's always a tough angle if you don't hit the net right there. That puck's going to go a long ways the other way. I may have done it once or twice. Nanooks carry the puck back in. UAA, though, Brandon LaJoie will carry out to the neutral zone. He'll take a hit as he crosses his own blue line and send the puck deep into the Nanook end. Britt Bamber down there trying to chase it down for the Seawolves. Matt Allen had it, tried to feed a pass through. That's broken up. And Fairbanks will come right back out. Pass deflected all the way down off a Seawolf stick, so no icing. And the puck is rimmed around the boards. Connor Merritt trying to pick that one up, able to flip it out to center ice. No further, though, as the Nanook send it back in. Carter Belitsky skating on this line right now with Merritt and Helgeson. And there's a race for the puck. Merritt trying to get there, not quite able to beat out Cade Nielsen. Puck sent right back into the Fairbanks end. Took a weird hop through Kevin Falk, and the puck goes into the net. They're going to wave it off immediately. There was a penalty coming up. The puck got sent towards the net by the Seawolves. The Seawolf player, here you see Carter Belitsky, just kept feeding that one, or kept moving with the puck in front of him right into the chest of Matt Radomski, and ended up pushing Radomski into the goal. So no goal. However, it will be a power play for UAA. 17:54 to go in the period.
Yeah, that'd be the ultimate of garbage goals. But Matt Shasby is waving his arm. Maybe getting a little bit of an explanation here. Maybe I'll take it.
I don't think there's really much of a leg to stand on right there.
I don't want to be blown dead when blue touched it.
Yeah, yeah.
In the blue paint area.
And it was in Radomski's belly button, so. Officials down explaining things to Derek Hamlin and I want to say Garrett Pike. Yes. So another look at it for the crowd on YouTube. There's a trip. And that's called on Carl Falk. And for Carl Falk, I would say that's probably a pretty good penalty to take right there after he had turned the puck over in the corner and he was pretty much in scramble mode. So not a bad idea to prevent a high quality scoring chance. But UAA now, here we go again.
I just love this video, Matt Shasby. He doesn't like it, no matter what he's being told. He's going to sell that, no, we deserve better. But at the very least, the Seals have a power play opportunity coming up here.
Yeah, so you can see right there.
No more helpless play in hockey than where Carter Belitsky is just going forward and knowing he's running into humans. There's really not much he can do there.
You know, but on that look, I could see where Shasby could have found a little bit of ground to question that call. So here we go. Fourth power play of the night for the Seawolves. Carter Belitsky to Bamber. Shot goes wide of the net. Helgeson gathers back in. Still with it, tries to feed it across to Belitsky, or to Hamlin. Kept alive in the zone with Belitsky. Here's Merritt now. Back to Helgeson. Fights off a hook momentarily, but the Nanook's able to pull that one away and send it all the way down the ice. Minute 15 left on power play number 4 for the Seawolves. Matt Johnson up the left wing boards. Rims that one around behind the Fairbanks net. Carson Kozabud furthered it a little bit. Now here's Almquist. Centers a pass to Johnson. Shot. Looked more like he was trying to pass to somebody, but the person he was trying to pass to wasn't there. So that one deflects up into the netting. And we'll have another faceoff in the Nanook zone. 16:46 to play here in period number two. We have no score.
Matt Johnson taking the educated guess there, thinking he's going to have that guy on the left wing possibly be open in the slot or in the circle, to no avail.
Off the draw, Almquist wins that one back for the Seawolves. Gilson trying to free his stick up and not able to do so. And the Nanooks rip it all the way down the ice one more time. Nolan Kent leaves off for Finley. And Finley decides to carry ahead. Now he's going to try the right side. Puck sent in deeper, back around the boards, kept alive by Finley at the left point. Now it's Gilson. And Almquist back to Gilson. Shot from straightaway, deflected in front. And Radomski able to spot that one and put a glove on it. Another look here at that nice little saucer pass up to Gilson. Not sure if it was Johnson that got a stick on that or one of the Nanook defenders, but it was definitely tipped on the way through. Good save by Radomski. And off the draw, the Nanooks win that one, ripping it around the boards. Gilson not able to keep that one in at the right point, and Dylan Finley will gather that in with 5 seconds left in the man advantage. Two shots on goal credited to the Seawolves with the power, or during the power play. And it's set out of the neutral zone. Nice, ended up being a nice pass as he connected to Matt Cothy. Tried to center one there, broke it up. Shot comes through, that hits traffic, goes wide of the net. Jared White trying to force that one out to the neutral zone and does so. And now here's Matt Johnson up the left wing. Johnson throws one towards the front of the net. Nobody home for the Seawolves. Jared White tried to do the same from the other side. Shot comes in this time from Kozabud. And Radomski's had enough of that. He'll throw the glove on that one and hold up for another whistle. I'm not sure if these two songs really mesh together. Off the draw, TJ Lloyd sends it up into the neutral zone. Glove down by Osborne. He'll just send it right back into the Fairbanks end. Will Hulficker, sends that one ahead. Puck ricochets out in front of the Seawolf net. Caleb Height backhands it back into the neutral zone. Hilfiker with it back on his stick. Pass intercepted, and Gomez gives off 2-on-1 chance for the Seawolves. But Jamie Collins lost an edge and threw that one. Big hit put on now. Walking in, shot, save. Made the opportunity by Matt Cothy as he walked in after Hilfiker and Kozabud came together. Caleb Height backhanding it right back out to the neutral zone. Alex Gomez can't reach it. And Jamie Collins will carry ahead one more time. Leaves off for Caleb Height. Shot comes in right into the glove of Radomski, and he will melt it down. And we'll have another faceoff in the Fairbanks end, down to 14:21 left in our second period.
I think we figured it out. Radomski's glove hand is okay tonight.
So yeah, yeah.
Let's try to switch it up a little bit, a couple shots in a row. Pretty easy for Matt to glove those.
UAA has come back to tie the shots on goal board with the first five here in this period. Off the draw, trying to carry out was Simon Falk. It's deflected off of his stick and sent right back in by the Seawolves. Circling the net, Comels leaves off. Now it's Simon Falk the other way. Colin Doyle chips it into the Seawolf zone, works his way around Hamlin. Brandon LaJoy will pick it up. Run into by a pair of Nanooks. UAA not able to clear the zone. McCauley keeps it alive for Fairbanks. He goes back to the point with it, and it's backhanded deeper in by Millamook. And that shot gets deflected up into the net. Let's take a break. 13:42 to go. Period two. We have no score.
Thank you.
It's okay to make a change, to need a new direction, to be the new kid on the block. We all find ourselves at a point in our lives where we're unsure about what's next. You can find it at the University of Alaska Anchorage. Whether you're looking for a career change, a community, or just a fresh start, we have those answers for you and more. Discover what's next at UAA. Apply today.
.13:42 to play in second period action of the 2022-23 Alaska Airlines Governor's Cup Game 4. Puck sent in, Nolan Kent sticks that one aside. Backhanded deeper into the Seawolf zone there by Cade Nielsen. Comes it back up to the point, kept alive by the Nanooks. Pass goes astray, and UAF forced to just chip it back into the Seawolf zone. They're offside, so they'll have to tag up and give UAA a chance to come out. Derek Hamlin, pass ahead to Connor Merritt. Flips it deeper into the Nanook zone. Max Helgeson down there along with, looks like, Will Hilfiker. Puck finally comes free. It's Nielsen. Long pass ahead. Doesn't connect with anybody. It will go on net, though, so that'll eliminate the icing. And yeah. Connor Merritt throws a pass dangerously to no one through the middle of the ice. Still with it. And finally taking it off of Rupsob's stick and sending it down the ice are the Nanooks, or are the Seawolves, excuse me. Puck back in the Fairbanks end. Seawolves changing behind the play. The Nanooks start ahead. Brady Risk with it. Shot deflected. Up and over the net. Almquist got a stick on that one for UAA. And we're down to 12, just over 12 and a half minutes to go in our second period. I caught a shirt. Did you see that? I caught a shirt.
I did see that.
Yeah.
And you acted appropriately like a six-year-old boy.
Heck yeah.
On Christmas morning.
Yes.
Nicely done.
Don't tell my daughter I gave it away, though.
Hey,
I'll never hear the end of it.
We got to make friends here.
Oh, yeah, yeah. TJ Lloyd carries the puck all the way in behind the Seawolf net. Ties
sure,
up back
I'm sure
there.
We could score 1-4 if we really ask the right people.
We've got a penalty coming up. I'm curious on that one.
Almquist.
Going to call a slash. It'll be two for slashing on Ben Almquist. Comes at the 7:39 mark. So this will be, I guess you could say, the first real power play attempt for the Nanooks. Their first one lasted only 6 seconds.
Definitely some stick work there. I don't know if there was one actual slash as much as just a more of a trip, maybe.
Yeah. But you got to figure that's what.
It was UAF's turn.
Four out of five had been called against UAF at that point. So, yeah, you're absolutely right. TJ Lloyd carries ahead for the Nanooks. Tries to filter a pass through. That's broken up by a Seawolf glove. And the Nanooks are back out to the neutral zone. Brady Risk gives off. And the Nanooks once again into the Seawolf end. Caleb Height intercepts that pass. He gets tied up by Brady Risk. TJ Lloyd gathers in the loose puck. Garrett Pike back to Lloyd. He's got some room into the circle. Lloyd still hangs on. He goes back to Pike. Pass across, shot deflected. Want to say that looked like Bamber, and now the puck comes loose through the neutral zone. Pike forced to chase that one down, and he gets there ahead of Jamie Collins. Collins trying to put a little bit of pressure on Pike to kill some more of that time.
Good work.
And here come the Nanooks back across the Seawolf blue line. Holding on to it is Rubsov. Now he throws it deeper into the zone. Kozubud gets to it first. He'll throw it up the wall. Kept alive, though, by, I want to say that was Bergmanis. Finally, Connor Merritt, once again, he'll get it on the tape. He'll throw it out into the neutral zone as we're down to 40 seconds to go on the Seawolf penalty. Cross-ice pass, a little bit of room to skate with it is Chase Dubois. He just sends it deeper into the Seawolf zone behind the net. Now we come back to the point to Bergmanis. Trying to walk that out down in front was Rupsov. Nolan Kent gave him nothing to shoot at, and the Seawolves able to pull that one free and send it back to the neutral zone. Cross-ice feed allows the Nanooks to send it into the zone. Nolan Kent comes out, and he'll just do that one himself to send it back to the neutral zone. And that's going to just about do it for this man advantage. Good penalty kill for the Seawolves, by far their best of the weekend. Only giving up one shot on goal during that man advantage. Jared White controls now for UAA. Leaves off for Almquist, fresh out of the penalty box. He gets blasted from behind. That's going to be a penalty on the Nanooks. So this will put UAA on power play number 5. 10:02, the time of the call. And it's going to be Bergmanis once again.
They can't ask for more opportunity. They just got to make something of them at this point.
Maybe a cross check. I'm thinking that's what he called.
Check from behind.
Check from behind. Power play number 5 now for the Seawolves. Oh, and it was Millimock, not Bergmanis. Shot comes in. Boy, Radomski. He went sprawling like he got tripped. Not sure if he did. I didn't see one. But the puck was still on Seawolf's sticks at that point and sent all the way down the ice now with a errant pass. Chip back into the Fairbanks end now. Jared White trying to catch up to that one. And that is sent up and over the boards into the Seawolf bench.
And Ben Almquist rushed into the zone inside the blue line and then it hit off his leg into the UA bench. He was well inside the zone on sides, but now they're calling it out to the neutral zone.
So 1:19 left on the man advantage. 9:16 left in our scoreless second period. Nice hit put on there to Carter Belitsky by Garrett Pike. Belitsky was trying to catch a pass, wasn't looking the right way, and Pike did exactly what he should have done, and that's step up and put him on his behind. Puck sent now deep into the Nanook zone. TJ Lloyd throws it deeper around behind the net, rolls into the corner, a pair of Seawolves there, sends back to Hamlin at the point. Hamlin down to Helgeson on the half wall. Helgeson hangs on, shot off the head of Radomski, yep. And boy, what a ricochet that one took. Holy cow.
Off the noggin, maybe off the netting, and then over here to the right-hand side.
And that missed the safety netting and ended up hitting just up underneath the cooler up there. Radomski is okay. So we'll have a face-off to his right. Off the draw, it's pulled away by Helgeson. Pass it up high to Hamlin. Shot hits traffic in front, rolls into the corner. Belitsky could have gotten away with a hold right there. But the Nanook's able to chip that one all the way down the ice. Kent way out of his net. He'll jump start play. Pass is intercepted at center ice by Comels. Nanook's trying to come right back into the zone. They're able to do so. Nolan Kent, though, he is not going to freeze it, not willing to take a faceoff in his own end. And the Seawolves will come ahead. Derek Hamlin with it on his stick as we're down to 20 seconds on the man advantage. Puck rimmed around the boards. Scrum of 5 players. It comes free on a Nanook stick. That clearing attempt broken up by Connor Merritt. Back to the point to Hamlin. Under 10 seconds to go on the power play. Pass down low. Oh, fanning on the shot chance was Belitsky. Boy, that was set up nicely. Kozabud keeps it alive, and that shot is deflected wide just as the power play expires. And the Nanooks are back to full strength and back into the Seawolf zone. Shot by Millimock right into the pads of Nolan Kent. 7:46 left. In period number 2, we have no score.
We've both seen enough hockey over the years to think that the next couple of penalties are probably going to come UA's way because they just had so many power play opportunities. And it's just human nature to kind of try to even them out. So you look for UAF to get a couple more power play opportunities coming up here.
Yeah, you know, I've got to say I'm a little surprised that that power play actually went the full 2 minutes, because there were a couple that I thought the Seawolves got away with, especially the one right down here on Carter Belitsky. So
I'm just amazed all this power play opportunity. And yeah, they're firing more shots from the timber, but there has not been one bounce or to hit inside, you know, in the slot area.
No.
All the bounces have gone out of play, have gone to the corners. Just, again, credit UAF's defense near Radomski and helping him out.
Yeah, and, you know, Radomski is senior goaltender, so he knows what he's doing back there. He's played a lot of hockey. And for the Seawolf fans, it's unfortunate because he's coming back next year as well. And that's going to be a trip. Yep.
There you go.
Is that going to be Dylan? No, that's going to be Jared White, too. They're going to call a hook. So that penalty comes.
An adamant hooking call coming from the official.
Another look at it here. Yeah, you know, I'm not going to say that's a bad call. He did get the stick up into the guy's hands as he was trying to curl around the net. So, and like you just said, there it is. Anything that's going to be close is going to be scrutinized a little bit more against UAA.
It's like we've been watching this game for quite a few years.
Yeah. So here we go. Power play number three for Fairbanks here. 0 for their previous two. And Brady Risk carries into the Seawolf zone as he is watched by Collins. Centering pass, hits traffic, doesn't connect with Israel's. Back to the point it goes. TJ Lloyd at the right point. Into the circle. Shot towards the net. Nolan Kent may have gotten a pad on that one as it's sent back out to the point. Kept alive there. Johnny Sorensen takes a return pass. Sorensen trying to curl away from Kozabud behind the net. Get some help from Israel's down there and Brady Risk. Back to the point. Now it's TJ Lloyd on the right side. Lloyd takes return feed from Sorensen. Cross ice to Pike. Shot comes in. Loose behind the net. Under a minute left in the power play. Pike. Cross ice. Nice save made there by Johnny Sorensen. Good job by Nolan Kent to push across and get that blocker up to send that one into the protective netting. Well set up, but also well defended by the Seawolves.
And Nolan rolling to his left, but he manages to get that right arm and go right with it. Get a little piece of it up into the netting. Good stuff from Nolan Kent.
Face off to Nolan Kent's left. Off the draw, quick shot and a nice save on Chase Dubois made by Nolan Kent. Boy, Dubois, it was just motto y motto right there. Nolan Kent swallowed that right in the Seawolf logo. So another draw to the left of the Seawolf net. And that one stays in the circle, kicked free to Bergmanis. Back to Bergmanis. Pass broken up, and Connor Merritt's got an opportunity here. If he can get around at Bergmanis, shot backhanded softly on net. Bergmanis played that really well as just angled Merritt right off to the side of the net. Back into the Seawolf zone with Rubstov. Back to Bergmanis, 23 seconds left in the power play. Nanooks with the puck on the half wall. Down low they go with it. Trying to set up that pass to Rubstov for the one-timer. No passing lanes there, and that puck's sent all the way down, and that's going to do it for this Nanook power play. So the Seawolf penalty kill, 3 for 3 tonight. And we remain scoreless with just over 5 to go in our second period. Gilson chips that one up the boards to Matt Johnson. He's trying to carry it out. Seawolves, though, not able to get it out of the zone till now. Matt Johnson is able to force it out, and we've got a penalty coming up. That's going to be on Fairbanks again. That's going to be an interference call, I do believe. Yep.
That was really quite bizarre because it was so far behind the play. Why make that attempt to even slow up Ben Almquist? We got a timeout.
Let's take a break. 4:50 left in the second. No score.
He's an Alaska Hockey Hall of Famer. Soon he'll be heading to the Brooklyn. Yeah. In support
So what's this, power play number 73 for
yes.
UA coming under the sun? I don't
yes.
know if that's fully accurate, but it may seem that way.
Off the draw, Nanooks control, and they will start by sending this one the length of the ice. Nolan Kent will come out of his net. He'll slow things down. Now it's Dylan Finley. Finley, pass gathered in off the boards. And now it's sent cross ice, looking for Jared White. Matt Johnson gonna try and chase that one down. Nicely kept in momentarily by Finley. Puck knocked off his stick. Nolan Kent way out of the net to play that one away from Harrison Israels. You hear the crowd cheering because Nolan Kent made that save at the top of the circles. Not sure if that would have counted, though. It looked like Fairbanks was still offside. Either way, save made. Almquist with it now on the far half wall. Cross ice, he goes to White. White gives off to Finley at the point. Finley back to Almquist. Almquist to Gilson. Gilson, Finley. Cross ice pass, boy, just hit a stick on its way to Almquist, and that's going to give Fairbanks a chance to carry it out. Nanooks just content to send it deep into the Seawolf zone. And Jared White chips it back in to the Nanook end, gets through Connor Merritt, and back out to the neutral zone it comes. Derek Hamlin gathers back in for the Seawolves. He goes cross ice with it and then takes return feed from Bamber. Hamlin still carries, leaves off for Merritt at the point. Merritt will rim it around, looking for Carter Belitsky. Belitsky tied up by a pair of Nanooks, is able to get it back to Bamber. Cross to Hamlin, now Bamber one more time. Bamber holds on, here's Helgeson, shot right into the belly button of Radomski once again, as we are down to 2 seconds.
Absolutely no rebound opportunity to speak of. Radomski doing a great job of just gobbling that one up.
2:52 to play in period number two. Stay tuned during the second intermission. You can watch my interview with Bruce Check, the radio voice of the Alaska Nanooks hockey team. And numerous other sporting events. Face off to the left of Radomski. Power play is over. Connor Merritt, though, turns the puck deeper into the Nanook end. Getting to it is Helgeson, swatted away from him. Puck still bouncing around down in the Nanook end. Finally, Fairbanks able to chip it out through the neutral zone and deep into the Seawolf end. Kozabud, the first one on it, rims it around for Belitsky. Belitsky's pass dangerously in front of the net. Caught and sent out of the zone, and now here's Helgeson trying to chase that down. Beating him to it, though, is Will Hilfiker. And Fairbanks able to get the puck back into the neutral zone. Back across the Seawolf blue line they come. Shot right into the glove of Nolan Kent. He'll go ahead and melt that down, and we'll have yet another faceoff. We know that everybody turned off the Bills-Dolphins game so they could listen to us. So that game is 29-29 at the two-minute warning in the fourth quarter. Buffalo has the ball at the Miami 38 first down. So there's your football update.
Here
pass chipped ahead. Caleb Height trying to chase that one down. He'll get to it first. Throws a shot towards the net. Radomski once again will steer it off that same wall he steered it off of earlier, right under the cooler.
At least you know pucks can deflect off of Radomski. He doesn't eat up every single shot. So
yes.
At least he is somewhat human, apparently.
The draw to the right of the Nanooks net. And Jamie Collins, thought he was going to get tossed out of the circle. He's just going to get a stern talking to. Draw one by the Nanooks. They're able to flip that one up. And Simon Falk will carry it out. and send it deep into the Seawolf end, down to a minute 43 left in our second period. Caleb Height catches up to it on the half wall, sends it all the way down. Icing is waved off as Alex Gomez will chase that one down with Garrett Pike. Pike wins it, sends it behind the net to TJ Floyd. Now it's Simon Falk. And Nolan Kent will come out of his net just a little bit this time to play that one into the corner. Brett Bamber behind his net to Hamlin. And now it's Connor Merritt backhanding that one up and out. Icing is going to be waved. It's not going to go far enough. Nanooks trying to circle his net with Comals. He's forced back by Caleb Height. Pass to the neutral zone, broken up. And UAA finally able to get that one back into the Nanook end as we are under a minute to play now in our second period. Shot towards the net, off sticks, and we'll have another faceoff in the Nanook zone with just under 50 seconds to play.
It may sound simplistic, but just the small decision making. I mean, UAA's done a much better job of that tonight. Just on that play right there, Kanash, no one does have a real open lane, has some traffic in front of him, but again, just throw it that way. And the Seals consistently kind of been making those decisions, just looking a little stronger than they did last night.
They've done a pretty nice job tonight of really trying to simplify things, and it's working.
It's boring, and it's not very flashy, you know, but given everything this team's been through in these last several months, that's what they got to do. And it's, you know, the old butts and seats analogy, maybe not, but it doesn't really matter at this point. It's
exactly.
Let's just grind it out and try to get something positive going.
It doesn't have to be pretty. The wins all count the same. So Almquist sends it up high up the wall, comes out at the feet of Jared White. He never saw it. Almquist once again, chip it into the Nanook zone. Almost turning it over behind the net there was McCauley. Puck still being dug for by the Seawolves. Now the Nanooks control, and they're out through center ice with 8 seconds left in the period. Kozabud maybe gets away with a little hook right there. Seawolves is trying to eat this up, and they will. They'll finish off the rest of this second period. No score between UAA and UAF. Game four of the 2022-23 Alaska Airlines Governor's Cup. And we're going to let these teams get off the ice, and then in just a minute or so, throw on the interview with Bruce Cech. But I think if you're Matt Chasby right now, a scoreless game, you've got to be pretty happy with most things except the power play.
Yeah, well, but and even like that last power play, I would submit, you know, everything looks right. Like Matt Johnson's doing a really good job, or Connor Merritt's doing a really good job of doing that front net presence. But the credit Radomski, credit the Nanooks, but the inability to create any second chances or ricochets or anything like that, it's going to eat at you a lot, and you're going to watch the film and kind of wonder why. But I think it's just one of those things, and it's been one of those things now for two nights in a row.
Yeah. And, you know, again, like you said, credit Matt Radomski. And the thing with him, too, is the shots aren't hitting him in the pads. You could get shots into the pads. That's going to create a lot of rebounds.
Like we're seeing that replay right there.
Exactly.
Matt Johnson's right where he needs to be, but Radomski just covers up immediately. End of possession, end of chance.
Another look at that save by Nolan Kent, who is able just to get the blocker on it and send that one up into the screen. So let's go ahead and take a break, and we're going to take a rest, Matt and I are, and we'll be back with more action from the third period.
You deserve it more than I do.
Yes. Either way, we'll be back.
And welcome back to the Seawolf Sport Complex here on the campus of the University of Alaska Anchorage. Game four of the 2022-23 Alaska Airlines Governor's Cup Series. And I'm pleased to be joined now by Bruce Cech, the radio voice of the Nanooks. And I'm not going to say just Nanook hockey, because you've kind of done it all in your time up at UAF.
Yeah, we did basketball. I made 3 trips out to Hawaii under the George Roderick era, so I got to see Honolulu and Hilo and all parts in between. And We played Washington in basketball. Got to call the very first Top of the World Classic championship game between Middle Tennessee State and Alabama, and that was fun. Al Sakaitis and I got to do it on Fox Sports Net.
You know, I remember the first Great Alaska Shootout I covered. I was pretty excited because it was on ESPN, and I didn't really do anything except stand on the sideline, but I knew it was me because I made sure to wear a bright orange hat. So I can say I've been on ESPN. Now, 34 years you've been with the Nanook athletic programs. What are some of the things in that amount of time that really stick in your head as, wow, this was really memorable, or, you know, something that I'll never forget?
Man, I've seen everything. Started with Rick Schaefer, head coach. We've seen Don Lucia, Dave Lorien. That was a Notre Dame connection. Guy Gadowski put us on the map. I mean, Guy basically put us to the best record we'd seen in years. Great point average in classroom. He was CCHA coach of the year. Not right now, he's at Penn State University, not doing too bad. We've seen guys from Colton Pareko is playing in the National Hockey League. Aaron Voros and Chad Johnson, a goaltender. I think he played for 9 different teams. He's pretty much a backup goaltender.
Yeah, he definitely made the rounds. You guys have had some really, really solid players come through there. You mentioned a couple of them. Other guys come to mind, Wiley Rogers, both Morley's, mainly Tyler, because he was the better of the two, in my opinion. But, you know, you've been a part of this series 34 years. So you've seen these two teams play each other close to 100 times. What are some of the things that you remember from this series with these two teams that, you know, that maybe you shouldn't tell?
Well, I got to think that the best one, we're down basically by a goal late in the game. There's 34.3 seconds on the clock at the Carlson Center. You know, it's game two of the Gov Cup. We're already down 1-0. We scored a goal to tie up the game. That was with 28 seconds on the clock. 10 seconds later, you guys pull the goaltender. We get a goal with the goaltender out, and we scored with no time on the clock. So we scored 3 goals in the last 34.3 seconds to win by a score of 5-3.
Oh, that's brutal. Not if you're an Nanooks fan, of course, but that's brutal. You know, 34 years, what have you seen? What are some of the big changes you've seen, not necessarily just in the Nanook program, but in the Alaska system as a whole? Because, like you said, you've seen it all.
Well, you know, we were an independent. We went from Division II to Division I as an independent. We're now playing as independent again, not by choice, but CCHA, WCHA. I saw the long pants. I was at the Cooperall long pants that Steve Morey wore when they played up at the Patty Center. We saw the Carlson Center come into play with the big Olympic ice. And like I say, I've seen, I think 9 or 10 different coaches, even more as far as athletic directors go. And over my span, I think I've called over close to 1,200 games. When you count basketball, I've logged over 1 million miles. I went everywhere from Orono, Maine to Tempe, Arizona, from Seattle, Washington, down to Huntsville, Alabama. Everywhere in between, you count basketball, I got to Hawaii 3 times.
And, you know, this, we've talked earlier, this is your first road trip of the season. You're not traveling with the guys anymore, which is not fun, because for where we sit, that's, I think, one of the most fun parts of our job, is we get to go to these different places that most people don't really want to go to, per se, but we like to go there because you see some really neat arenas. You know, you look at places like Michigan Tech, you look at Taffy Able, Sault Ste. Marie. That's what I was trying to think of. Lake Superior State. There we go. And, you know, you got to see also all the great rinks up in the CCHA when the split came with Fairbanks and Anchorage. Anchorage went to the WCHA, Fairbanks to the CCHA. You got to see Yost and Munn and a lot of those great arenas. That
Value City Arena and Ohio State. In fact, Scott Rosellis, my old radio TV partner, we did some television from Ohio State at one time. 17,000-seat rink for hockey.
That's like Wisconsin.
Yes.
You know, and that's a place that I never got to go is Wisconsin. But, yeah, they have some just amazing facilities in the Midwest. They're hockey towns, hockey schools. And when you think of Michigan Tech, I think is maybe one of my favorite road trips that I got to go on. You get in there, you get the student band, you get the singing in the third period. It's such a great atmosphere. And I think the best thing I enjoyed about Michigan Tech is when I went to the games, we never lost.
Well, you should go up there for a winter carnival when they basically close the road there. The students basically cover the highway with snow drifts and nobody gets in and out of Houghton Hancock. But it's not an easy place to get to, but they have a lot of hockey history there.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. And, you know, you mentioned Huntsville, Alabama. That was the first place I ever called a game on the road for UAA back in 2015. And I was terrified because the press box is so high.
Chicken wire.
And I'm just trying to figure out how am I going to do this, because the week before we were at the Sully and you know, you're right there with the players. You can see everybody's name on their back, and now I'm trying to figure out how I'm going to do this at Huntsville Arena when I can't see anything besides maybe the size of an ant.
No bathroom there either, so you better have a long interview for in between periods. But even more impressive, we called the game down there on Military Appreciation Weekend. These guys were in camouflage uniforms, so you tried to, you couldn't even pick up the numbers. In fact, I know they had a goal. They changed three times because the first two times they listed the goal, neither guy was on the ice. That's how bad it was to pick up numbers.
I've heard stories like that about Bemidji State also, when they would do a military appreciation night. It was just miserable. What do you have a favorite rink that you got to go see in the CCHA days?
I really liked Lake Superior State. We were kind of like here. You're in with the crowd a little bit. You've got a great sight line. You're not too far away. Northern Michigan wasn't too bad either. You know, then you look at Michigan State, obviously some iconic places to play at. I love that new Pagula Ice Arena. We went to Penn State,
beautiful.
And Guy Gadowski's there. What was it, $100+ million that they put together there for that arena? And that was a great place there. And then, of course, at the bottom of the list was the old ASU rink at Tempe, Arizona. I was told I couldn't have a color guy because we were concerned that we might have too much weight up there and kind of crash 15 feet down to the lobby where the fans were sitting.
You know, with as bad as Oceanside was when ASU was playing there, that's upgraded. The last time I played at Oceanside was before ASU's varsity team was D1. They were still clubs. And that place was terrible, putting it nicely. So they made serious upgrades before ASU ever moved in to become a D1 school.
Oh, no doubt about that. Like I say, it was quite the arena. We're having an alumni weekend this year at that brand new Mullet Arena coming up in February. And it was Scott Rizzella. Steve Morey, the Nanooks all-time point getter, is coming over from England. He'll be there, so I'm hoping to score a road trip to that one.
I don't blame you. I've talked to some of our players. We played down there earlier this season, and they said it was amazing. So, I mean, obviously some of that is going to be input from the Coyotes, but there's a lot of money that gets dumped into that program. And, you know, it's not long before you're going to see every year consistent success out of them. It's just they're I hate to say they're still building, but they are still in that building phase. They've only been around, 7 years now,
yeah.
I think?
And their fans are pretty knowledgeable. I was watching the games with UAA down there, watching the video cast. Their fans are learning the chants. They're getting into the game of hockey down there, and it's they're going to be able to pick whatever conference they want to be in. I still think the Big Ten might be calling their name.
They've got the money for it.
Yeah.
You know, they really do. And it's not a bad place to be. Look at some of the schools that are there. You've got top 10 teams dotting the entire Big Ten right now. And, you know, Arizona hockey has grown so much. That's where I started to play. Back in 1980, wow, when I was 4 years old, was in Phoenix, Arizona. So looking at hockey then to hockey now, Oceanside would have been up to date back then. And unfortunately, they didn't update it anymore until ASU got their team. So you knew how old it was. So 34 years you've been doing this. And we were talking today because we ran into each other at the Fifth Avenue Mall.
Yeah.
You just bought a house in Michigan.
Yeah, right now I'm not traveling, so I'm actually calling the road games via video, and it's working out. We're hoping to do vice versa next year, where I'll be able to call the games from the Carlson Center from my house in Michigan and maybe make a few road trips. I know the Nanooks have Michigan Tech and Northern Michigan on the schedule next year. That's right around the corner from where I live, so hopefully I can continue to do stuff there. I want to give a shout-out to Tina. You talked about road trips. This is my first road trip coming down here in like 3 years, and when I got to the airport, I grabbed my luggage, got to the hotel. It wasn't my luggage. I want to thank Tina from Wasilla for giving me back my luggage, and I got hers back to her too. So,
now, I know we're getting short on time, so I'm just going to ask you this one last question is, how great is it for the Governor's Cup to finally be back on the ice?
What was it, 1,014 days when we played last weekend in Fairbanks? It's great, and like I say, I think the future is bright. We're rooting for UAA. They're rooting for UAF. As long as we don't play each
exactly.
other, we need each other to continued success, to get into a conference, and I see some brighter future down the line, including a new arena next door here, I'm told.
I hope so. Definitely hope that's in the works. The plans have been drawn. It looks beautiful. So, Bruce, I thank you very much for your time. And, you know, you're one of the first road announcers I ever met, and I appreciate all the assistance you've given to me in the times that we've crossed paths. And best of luck tonight, I guess I can say that, since we're being friendly, and we'll see you again in January.
So when you met me, you must have been like in junior high school, right?
I wish. Holy cow, I still had hair back then.
Never a dull moment. Hey, go Seawolves, go Nanooks.
I agree 100%. We'll be back with more Seawolf hockey in just a few moments.
Seawolf Sports Complex, game four of the 2022-23 Alaska Airlines Governors Cup Series. Scoreless through two periods. Let's take a look at some stats.
Plenty of them.
Yeah, stats, that is. There are. Shots on goal through two periods. Fairbanks, 10 in the first, 8 in the second, two-period total of 18. Seawolves, 5 in the first, 8 in the second, two-period total of 13. I did say 18 for Fairbanks, right? Okay.
Yeah.
It's getting late. Power plays tonight. Fairbanks, 0 for 3. They put three shots on goal with those man advantages. UAA, 0 for 6. And they have recorded 7 of their 13 shots on the power play. Penalty minutes, 6 for 12. For Fairbanks, 3 for 6 for the Seawolves. Both goaltenders have been perfect so far. Matt Radomski of the Nanooks, Nolan Kent of the Seawolves. So, 20 minutes away. As far as the Governor's Cup goes, this is a must-win for UAA. And as far as I think confidence goes, this is a must-win for UAA. You know, it's tough playing the same team four times in a row. It doesn't matter really what level you're at, but to lose four games in a row to the same team, that could be a tough one to swallow.
Yeah, the UA just has to believe that at some point that shot's going to bounce off a skate and lay right there, gift wrap for somebody. That's got to be the working premise here as they enter the third period.
And as far as the defensive side of things go, you know, the Seawolves have been pretty solid in their own end tonight. Nolan Kent has had pretty good vision of just about every shot, it looks like, from our point of view. And that's just something that's going to have to continue. You know, yep. Fairbanks is going to come out hard, come out fast, because the last thing they want to do is lose a game down here after as well as they played.
You got a feeling Eric Largent's going to be petitioning for another power play here to get those numbers a little more even. UA's going to want to be smart how they play here physically as we get going here in the third period.
All right. Players and refs are in position, so the puck is down. We are underway in our third period. Garrett Pike up the wall to Johnny Sorensen. He just backhands it into the Seawolf zone. Harrison Israels going into the corner with Ben Almquist. Now it's Sorensen tied up down there with another Seawolf defender. Jared White can't backhand that one out of the Seawolf end, and it's sent all the way back around the net. Puck now tied up in the far corner. Israels gets it back to the point. TJ Lloyd. Garrett Pike throws one towards the net, deflected nicely up high by Johnny Sorensen. Nolan Kent able to get the pad down and make that save, and the Seawolves are back out into the neutral zone. Almquist carries up the right wing side, leaves off for White. Jared White trying to get around Garrett Pike, throws a puck back towards the front of the net. It goes all the way back through the point. Shot misses the net by Koza, but Gilson tees it up, lets it fly. Radomski gets that right pad on it and kicks it away. And that one is sent all the way down the ice. Icing is called, and we'll have a faceoff coming up back in the Nanook end. That was a good shot right there by Gilson, low on the ice, looking for the far post, but Radomski able to get that pad down and kick it out. So the faceoff to the right of the Nanook net. Stepping in to take the draw for the Seawolves, Matt Kanash against Harrison Israels. Israels pulls it back. And coming up the left wing side was Gaffney. He's able to get it to Israels in the neutral zone. He backhands it deep into the Seawolf net, and the Nanooks will go for a change. Matt Allen rubbed out of the play by Bergmanis at center ice. The puck trickles into the Nanook zone. Right back out, though. Gaffney goes cross ice with the pass. Chipped up into the Seawolf zone. Shot towards the net. Kent able to get a pad on that one.
Nope.
Out in front it goes. Shot save by Kent. A little deflection in front, it looked like, there by Rubstov. And the puck comes out of the Seawolf zone. Nanooks rip it right back in. Nice hand-eye right there by Brett Bamber to knock that one down out of midair. And he'll set things up from behind his own net. Pass ahead from Helgeson looking for Merritt. didn't handle it cleanly, and we're going to have a face-off coming up after an offside play. So we've seen quite a bit of this line tonight with Carter Belitsky joining Helgeson and Merritt. Typically, it's Matt Allen on the other wing from Helgeson and Merritt. And off the draw, Nanooks control. Chipping it softly into the zone is Kevin Falk. Hit put on down behind the net. Chase Dubois pulls the puck out. Loose momentarily and then is chipped up to the blue line. Thrown towards the net by Falk. And that's going to go up into the netting and the faceoff will remain inside the Seawolf zone with 17:48 to play in period number three. No score.
Seen a lot of pucks hit that net tonight.
Yeah.
And not the behind the net of the goal, but the protective netting.
Face off to the right now of the Seawolf cage. Max Helgeson and Colin Doyle. Doyle wins it back to Falk. His shot is blocked. And now Belitsky able to chip it up through the neutral zone. Icing is waved off. It's going to roll deep into the zone. Merritt and Falk come together in the right wing corner. Belitsky stepped into down there by McCauley. And a scrum of four players continuing to try and dig that one out. Merritt gets dumped on the play and McCauley comes away with the puck. Pulls up at the half wall, is able to chip it out as far as the neutral zone. Gets a little help from his friends now. And walking in with it is Doyle. Doyle pulls up at the top of the circle, throws a shot towards the net, hits something on the way through and changed direction. But fortunately for Nolan Kent, it went just wide of that far post. Osborne leaves off now. And it's sent ahead towards Caleb Height. Puck deflects deep into the Nanooks zone as the Seawolves complete a change. Garrett Pike with it behind his own net, gives off now. And up the left wing boards to Nielsen. He's run into, trying to chase that one down is Dubois. He's run into by Gomez. And then Gilson back down there to help out as well on Cade Nielsen. Back to the point it goes though to Pike. Cross ice to Lloyd. Lloyd has to avoid Caleb Height, get it in deep. Now it's Nielsen behind the net. Up the boards it comes, and Height can't get it out of the zone. Height with it on his stick one more time, goes back with it to Finley. Jamie Collins' pass ahead is deflected deep into the Nanook end by Caleb Height. Pike will be the first one on that one for Fairbanks. Sent up around the wall, trying to catch up to it, and it's shot by Bamber. Another shot comes in. Radomski got that one with the left pad, so both pads have done work in this period for Matt Radomski. Centering pass, not able to get a hand on that was Harrison Israels, and he takes a nice slash in the wrist from Derek Hamlin. Played it up a little bit as well, so didn't get the call. Here comes right back in was Kothi. Shot saved by Nolan Kent. He had a Seawolf riding his back the entire way there, but was still able to get a scoring opportunity. UAA chipping it back deep into the Nanooks zone. Radomski holds that one up for Falk. And the Nanooks will work it right back out through the neutral zone with Gaffney. Cross corner dump in by him, trying to get that one to Rubstov. He can't control it, and the Seawolves, once again, are back into the neutral zone. Matt Allen bumped off the puck at center ice. And now Rubstov turns it over right at his own blue line, gives off to Osborne. Osborne couldn't control that one cleanly, otherwise he might have had a chance to get in by himself. Nanooks still trying to clear the zone as their forwards are changing. Puck broken up in the neutral zone by Helgeson. He gets it across the blue line. Now it's Allen. Matt Allen's shot saved by Radomski. Not much to shoot out there by Matt Allen. It was a pretty tough angle. Scrum of four players come together. And keeping it alive is Gilson from the right point. Allen trying to chase that one down on the half wall. Gets it back to the point. Now it's Gilson. Throws one towards the net. Couldn't get the deflection he was looking for. Puck's still loose down there. Merritt has it come off of his stick. And the Nanooks are going to move ahead to the neutral zone. Gaffney carries it in, dumps it just wide of the net. Finley there for the Seawolves, Doyle there for the Nanooks. Back to the point it goes, TJ Lloyd just rolls it back into the corner behind the Seawolf net. Millamook trying to come out as he is watched by Gilson. Millamook with it on his stick one more time. Hangs on, curls away, trying to get free of Finley. Shot towards the net, deflected wide. Belitsky able to chop that one back out through the neutral zone. Nanooks trying to clear it, but not doing so cleanly at all. I believe that was McCauley back there. And the puck is back out now through the neutral zone, out of danger for Fairbanks. Caleb Height backhands it deeper into the Fairbanks end. Radomski plays it up the half wall, kept alive by Bamber. Jamie Collins couldn't control that one, or he may have had a scoring opportunity from the low slot area. Now it's Millimuck. Can't connect on a pass. Caleb Height backhands it right back into the Fairbanks end. 13:15 left here in our third period. We remain scoreless. Puck sent up the half wall. Backhanded up by Collins. Shot comes in. Hit traffic on the way. Never made it to the net. And now it's Brigmanis. Back up through the neutral zone with it. Brigmanis chipping it deep into the Seawolf end. Kothi gets a pass across. That was Peyton Matsui with the shot. Nolan Kent shut that down. Back to the point to Brigmanis. From the point, he throws it in wide of the net, looking for a deflection that never came. Now Caleb Height trying to get that one through Comels. Can't do it. And it's Kothi one more time. Shot saved by Kent as he got that one in the pads. 12:38 to go. Third period, no score. Timeout. Fairbanks holds a 3-0 edge right now. Off the draw, puck bounces out of the Seawolf end. Chasing that one down is Marcus Comels. Cross ice, he goes with it to Brigmanis. Brigmanis gets it ahead to Dubois, who gets it deep into the Seawolf end. Nolan Kent out of his net to play it up the wall. Seawolves able to backhand it out to the neutral zone. Jared White trying to get there. It was behind him in his skates. He had a hard time with that one. Now it's Harrison Israels, fends off a check from, I believe that was Almquist. And the puck goes into the corner. Israels is down there, Almquist, Kozabud as well. And Johnny Sorensen, finally Kozabud comes free on his stick, trying to protect that puck away, ends up turning it over, pass across, shot never got off the tape of Dubois, otherwise we may be sitting at 1-0 right now. Back across it comes. Almquist sends it deeper into the Nanooks zone now. 11:40 to play in the third period. Both teams completing changes. And now up it goes. Gaffney deflects it deep into the Seawolf zone. Nolan Kent once again out of his net to play that one ahead, looking for Allen. And it's chipped up to the point. Not out. Shot blocked down as Gilson recovers for UAA. He'll put that one off the glass and off into the Fairbanks bench. So the faceoff will come back into the Seawolf zone as we're down to 11:18 now to play in period number three. So I'm assuming that Buffalo won.
Walk-off 25-yard field goal from Tyler Bass in the blizzard-like conditions.
But honestly, more importantly, the Avalanche won.
I don't know if that's that important.
Oh, it is. It is. And Arizona basketball is winning. So again, those are the scores that matter to me.
Now, this has been an offensive battle, obviously, from the onset. What I've really enjoyed is, to a person, they're all really supporting one another. You're seeing, you know, smart plays in the defensive end. Just the, whether that's part of not wanting to make that mistake, but on both sides, white and blue, the guys have made just a good job of playing, being in the right position. They haven't seen too many hiccups with really bad turnovers, just a few here and there.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Merritt, nice job to get his head up right there. Otherwise, he would have gotten drilled by TJ Lloyd. Brett Bamber fires that one in wide of the Nanook net. And
another visit to the Nanook bench.
Sending it back up into his own bench, Colin Doyle. And again, not the way you want to make friends on the team, shooting pucks at him. Good play there by Finley. Fairbanks bench wanted a penalty for hooking on him, but none is coming as the Seawolves cross the blue line. Then they come offsides and chip it back into the Fairbanks end. Nanooks now back into the neutral zone momentarily as it's Caleb Height recovering the puck for the Seawolves. Gilson fires a puck off Alex Gomez's shin pads. And it's kind of a hot potato right now. Finally, Fairbanks will settle things down and walk ahead. Getting it into the zone is Kofi. Gilson first one to it for the Seawolves. Up the half wall he comes to Gomez. Gives off now to Jamie Collins. Pass across by Collins to White. That one it's off a stick. And into the netting one more time. 9:54 to play in our third period.
It's been fair at each end in terms of offensive to zone time, but obviously the Seawolves just had no luck getting any real shots on. Their shot-o-meter has been stuck at 15 for quite a while.
Yeah, definitely has. Kozbud trying to get away from one Nanook. He's able to do so, and up through center ice he comes. Kozbud still with it, and his shot deflects up into the netting one more time. Down to 9.5 to go here in period number three.
John Jolly's running out of official game pucks down there in the penalty box there. He's doled out quite a few of them to the officials tonight. With their swanky Alaska Airlines Governor's Cup logo on them.
Ooh, that could have been a check from behind. Nothing was called. And then Nanooks back out into the neutral zone. Rubstoff carries ahead, backhander to Nolan Kent. Has no problem with that one. And we'll bring a faceoff back into the Seawolf end. Now, the way things are going right now, the Seawolves haven't scored a goal in... ...14.5 periods. Their last goal came at Arizona State in the third period of the 5-2 loss of the first game down there. Puck deep in the Seawolf, or I'm sorry, in the Nanook end is sent deep into the Seawolf end. Carson Kozbud trying to escape from Simon Falk. Is able to do so, but sends it all the way down for icing. So we'll bring a faceoff back into the UAA end one more time. As wondering if we were going to get a whistle right there for maybe hitting somebody on the Seawolf bench. And right now we're at a point in the game where the officials can't get a break. Every whistle is going to be challenged in some way by one of the two benches.
You know, and it's not like goal scoring has just been something here this weekend that's been a problem. They've scored, UAV's only scored three goals three times in their previous actual game. So, as expected, when this new group of guys get together, just looking for opportunities, you know, offense is definitely not the strong point of this squad. They scored three goals when they won on an opening night against Western Michigan, three goals when they won at Northern Michigan on October 22nd, and three goals when they lost to Air Force November 4th at the Service Academy. So again, we're not seeing anything all that unusual.
No. Ooh, weird hop out in front, pass out in front. And Johnny Sorensen couldn't get that to where he wanted it to go off the pass from Matt Cothey. Back in behind Matt Radomski now. Plays into the corner where Matt Helgeson was, Max Helgeson. Helgeson with it back now on his stick momentarily, then it's knocked off. Nanooks come through the neutral zone, putting a hit on with Belitsky. Garrett Pike received that one. And the shot rolls into the equipment of Nolan Kent. We've got some hurt feelings. And taking a tumble is Matt Cothey. And we'll see if anything materializes penalty-wise out of this. I would hope not. There was.
Well, if you're either team, you're just trying to dare the officials into calling anything.
Exactly.
They don't want a power play, even though there has been no answer on any power plays to decide the outcome of this game.
Yeah.
But again, doesn't mean they're going to try to not. That the players are probably going to try to egg it on as much as they can.
Another look at that shot there. That's swallowed up by Nolan Kent. And Derek Hamlin, a little punch to the shoulder of Cothey, who went down. And there was some season's greetings after that. And cooler heads prevail. Faceoff to the right of the Seawolf net, 7:56 to play, third period, no score. Off the draw, back to Kevin Falk. Shot high over the net, may have been deflected by Dylan Finley. Opportunity coming right there for Cade Nielsen. So the faceoff will remain inside the Seawolf zone, only they're gonna move to the far side. Shots on goal, 27 for the Nanooks, 15 for the Seawolves. Which means they only have two in this third period. Back to the point it goes, Kevin Falk, his shot deflects wide. Out to the other side is McCauley, throws it deeper into the Seawolf end. Shot turns towards the net, and it's put high into the air. Deflects free to Kozabud. Tries to go back with it to Gilson. Back to the point, though, it goes. Shot towards the net, deflected wide off Chase Dubois' stick. Now it's Matsui in the right wing half wall, throws it back down into the corner. Almquist trying to filter that one through to Kozabud. Check from behind,
right,
that's an easy call. And Carson Kozabud is going to go sit for probably a check from behind, I'm guessing. The 2-minute variety, I would think. Let's take a break. We'll be back. 6:59 left in the third.
Thank you.
Carson Kozuba, 2 minutes, check from behind at 13:01, puts the Nanooks back on a power play. And they are 0-3 with that man advantage tonight. Off the draw, Pike, TJ Lloyd, shot wide of the net. Hamlin picks up the loose puck, can't clear. TJ Lloyd nicely kept in. Keeps it on that half wall. Sent back up to Pike at the right point. Back to Lloyd. Lloyd still at the hash mark on the left circle. Johnny Sorensen, he'll switch places with Lloyd. Back out to the point to Brady Risk. Risk gets it in, shot save made by Nolan Kent off Israel's attempt. Good shot by Harrison Israels. And then the pass is awry and back out into the Nanook zone. Minute 20 left on the power play, 6:18 left in our third period. Head with it is TJ Lloyd. Still carrying, sends it around behind the Seawolf net and sending it up the wall but not out was Brett Bamber. I think Bamber didn't realize he had a lot more time than he took. Finally, getting it out of the end is William Gilson. Sorensen has it knocked off his stick, so he can't enter cleanly, and he goes back to Garrett Pike. Now it's Sorensen with it one more time, curling through the neutral zone. Risk takes a pass on the near side boards. Tried to leave a puck off, but there was nobody on the point as it was vacated while the Nanooks changed up defenders. 40 seconds left on the man advantage. Dylan Finley leaves off, and Almquist will send that one hard off the wall. It gets through Matt Gothy. Nanooks carry right back into the zone, though. Bergmanis, the left point. Cross ice, he goes with it. Hanging on is Rubstoff. Cross ice pass, shot is blocked off Dubois' stick. Dubois has it back. He goes down low, takes a return feed. Centering pass, Bergmanis takes the shot wide of the net. May have hit some traffic on the way through. Bergmanis with it one more time. 5 seconds to go on the man advantage. Pass goes down low. Empty net, scored. Right as the power play expired, the pass came across, and Chase Dubois was able to find nothing but net to shoot at, and he hit it. 1-0 Nanooks lead. Another look here, Bergmanis. Good patience by the Nanooks. They weren't trying to force anything, but the pass is sent down low, and then a beautiful feed across from Matsui right on the tape of Dubois. Nothing that Nolan Kent could do about that one, and it's 1-0.
Arguably the first time we've seen any kind of connection made in the slot area tonight. UAF, I took advantage. You know, we said it was had to be a real obvious penalty, which it was. Opened the door to that power play opportunity. They score right at the end of it.
So that is an even strength goal. The power play had expired. And now what do the Seawolves have as far as an answer goes? Puck is deep in their own end. Fairbanks maintains possession down there. Millamook trying to chase that puck down. UAA able to win it back though. Hamlin goes up the wall with it, and that's going to go the distance. Icing will be called as we're down to 4:18 to play in period number three. 1-0. The Nanooks take the lead. Dubois with the goal. Matsui had one assist. And I think Rubstov may have had the second.
Well, you could say Nolan Kent, the Seawolves deserve better, but deserves got nothing to do with it, as Clint Eastwood famously said in Unforgiven.
Yep.
You get what you get, and they just have not been able to find that offensive opportunity. UAF did, to its credit. I mean, if anything, Matt Shasby and the staff knows that they played better tonight, and
yeah,
that, you know, speaks to the character of the group, to their willingness. I mean, it's not over yet. They got 4 minutes to try to make something happen, but they did just about everything right up until that point.
That's all it takes, though. One breakdown.
Yeah, really, like, that was the one cross-ice pass the whole night, really.
Yeah, there haven't been any seam passes getting through either way. And that one, that was the one. Matt Johnson goes back with it, and now it's Osborne. Cross-ice pass, Johnson will play that one off the board. Johnson into the Nanook zone, still with it, gives off to Almquist. Shot comes in, hits traffic. Rebound comes in, and Gilson, no, I believe that was Osborne, shot was blocked, and the Nanooks right back the other way. Gothy leaves off, or tries to leave off, for Comals, broken up by the Seawolves, and Carson Kozabud behind his own net to Osborne. Here's Almquist now up the right wing side, cuts toward the middle. Pass off to Allen at the blue line. Scrum of five players. And the puck finally comes out on a Nanook stick. And Garrett Pike trying to get that one out of the Nanook zone. Seawolves, though, doing a nice job to keep it alive. As soon as I say that, though, Fairbanks is able to chip it free. Anton Rubsoff sends it down the ice. No icing, 2:48 left in our third period. 1-0, Fairbanks on top. Dylan Finley now carries ahead, dumps it deep in. Radomski just backhands that one softly into the corner. And Fairbanks will exit their zone. Set around behind the Seawolf net. Nolan Kent leaves off for his defenseman. Here's Bamber up the right wing side. Sent in off the stick of Belitsky. Belitsky down there steps into A.J. McCauley. McCauley still had the puck on his stick, and he's able to send it out as far as the neutral zone. Bamber can't handle it cleanly. Now it's a two-on-one opportunity for Fairbanks, and Fanning on the shot on the far side. I believe that was Peyton Matsui. And the net is empty for UAA as Nolan Kent is on his way to the bench. Minute 50 to go here in our third period. 1-0, Fairbanks on top. Puck sent back up the half wall, kept alive by Kozabud. Merritt trying to send that further along behind the net. Cut off down there by McCauley. Fairbanks can't clear the zone. Belitsky with it on his stick. Almquist tries to steal it back. Kozabud, nice job to keep the puck in the zone. Finally, Fairbanks will put that one high in the air, and that will go just wide, but it will go for icing with 1:22 to play in period number three. I would expect to see Matt Chazby use his timeout right here, even on an icing.
UAF going to call timeout here.
There it is.
You're amazing. Okay.
Take as much time as you can.
Everyone got a long enough break as it is, so
yeah.
Let's just call the timeout and talk it over. They never got the breather there one way or the other. So. I don't know, David. I mean, there's such a, I don't know if I want to say a negativity, but so much of what surrounded this UA program before it went dormant, while it was dormant, since it's been recreated, there's just a kind of feeling to it. But a night like tonight, yes, are they struggling to find an offensive sweet spot? Yes, but there's something to be said for the general effort and the ability, maybe, even though being outshot 2-1, they've really only given up that one goal on the one play that we've seen made here tonight. So am I trying to find excuses for Matt Chazby and this team? I don't think so. I guess I'm just kind of looking, as I've said many times, the big picture of all this. What are we doing? What are we doing as a state? What are we doing as a city? What are we doing as a collegiate institution? I mean, is this stuff we want? A bunch of people are going to go home tonight or listening right now. Yeah, but they have no offense. They have no goal scorers.
Right.
Okay, that might be, but what? But what's the back end of that? Oh, it should all just vanish and all the hard work that's been done these last few years should be for naught. No, let's let this gestate a little bit. Let's let it grow up into something.
Yeah.
And yeah, there's gonna be a whole bunch of lumps along the way, but this is something that should be part of this community, and I just hope that doesn't get lost on the powers that be and just the rank and file fan who wants to be entertained on a Saturday night, you know. And it's a struggle, I get it. And come up with ways for you and I to describe it. It gets more and more difficult. Shout out to our friends who've sat in this position before over the years when these teams have struggled the way they have. But I don't know. There's just a fundamental I see it as a necessity. I mean, that Division I college hockey is something that belongs in this state. And
yeah.
If there's somebody with a lot more sway than me that's going to say something else, that decision needs to be made somewhere down the road, I guess.
Right. Yep.
But for now, you know, just credit them for the effort. They have a chance here with the goalie pulled, a minute 22 to go.
1:22 to play here in our third period. So after both teams call their timeouts, Bamber shot on net is blocked away, and then Fairbanks takes a shot at the Seawolf net. It goes wide for icing, but that kills 9 seconds of clock for the Nanooks.
Thinking about that, it wasn't the goalie shooting, but earlier today, Jeremy Swayman anchored his own. Former UA stick boy nearly scored an empty netter in the Bruins' win this morning. He won that game. I believe he had 28 saves or something like that, but I guess he just missed an empty netter by a tick.
Too bad. So, had a false start on the faceoff, so we're going to reset the clock and
some
do
clock
it again.
Check here.
Well, Seawolves are going to have to figure out a way to get a shot on net.
That would help.
If they're going to score a goal. They only have two so far in this third period, and it has been tough sledding in that Fairbanks end. Officials trying to get the clock back to the 1:13.
Got 2 seconds to put back on the clock.
Yep. Off the draw, one by the Seawolves. Gilson trying to spin away. Hamlin throws one wide of the net. Down there, Connor Merritt trying to get it out in front. Cannot do so. Now it's Gilson. Down low to Merritt. Oh, just wide of the net. Rebound! Radomski comes across with that glove and makes the save. Well, there's the shots on goal I was asking for. The backhander from Merritt and the rebound, getting it quickly off his stick.
Well, there's a moment for Matt Radomski right there. You knew it had to come up some point. His ability to move from his right to his left that quickly and get that rebound chance and turn it aside.
That's going to cost the Nanooks their centerman. He's going to get thrown out. No.
Seawolves doubled their shot total in the third period on
yes,
that.
In that two-second flurry. Bamber goes cross ice to Hamlin. Shot wide. Off the back of the net, it's Almquist to Helgeson. Back to Bamber at the right point. Back to Helgeson. Almquist gets through him. Getting to it first is Gilson. He's tied up down there, though. Puck free to Almquist. Shot out to Bamber. Hits traffic, rebound! And it's still loose down by the blue paint. It's behind the net to Almquist. 20 seconds to go. Back to the point to Hamlin. Bamber. Hamlin. Gilson. Shot. Save. Up into the netting. And we've got one more faceoff with 12 and a half seconds to play.
Blue legs and arms everywhere,
yep.
No matter what UA tries. Just, again, credit the UAF defensive intensity. Their ability to sell out all over the place.
So face off to the right now of Matt Radomski. Up the draw. It's chipped
hey, one more
up
puck
into
out of
the
play.
Net. Matt, the hockey department is going to have to invest in some more game pucks. So I believe to start the season, they only had 200. 9.3 to play. Almquist to take the draw for the Seawolves. Colin Doyle in the circle for Fairbanks.
I think we're going to have time adjustment again.
Thank you. Seawolves are off next
week. Our official scores, all the pressure of the whole world is on them right now. The whole arena is watching them. And he knows how it works. He just can't quite compute in real time with all the eyeballs on him. It's a rough one.
So the Seawolves are off next week. Following weekend, they're at UMass Lowell, followed by a trip to the University of Maine before coming home 2 weeks later to take on Fairbanks in game number 5 of the Alaska Airlines Governor's Cup Series. Game number 6 will be the following night in Fairbanks.
Oh, the body language of people, Eric Largent and his staff, are just irate. The Seawolves are getting this much time to discuss strategy. So we went from, that's not correct, so it must be 10.5.
Seawolves will take that.
I believe we're trying to get to 10.5.
Then following that homestand or that home and home with Fairbanks, Seawolves have nearly a month off before they travel to Connecticut and LIU between February 23rd and the 28th. They'll then close out the season March 3rd and 4th with Arizona State here at the complex, and then March 10th and 11th against Lindenwood also here at the Seawolves Sport Complex. So doesn't get any easier for the Seawolves, that's for sure. So we're going to go ahead and throw 12 minutes back on the clock. I'm sure Eric Largent's blood pressure right now is through the roof.
This is the worst feeling in the world.
Going to apologize to all you lip readers watching on YouTube for Eric Largent. Well, Rad, I want to say thanks to our production crew, as they have all season. They've been absolutely outstanding. Jerry Levine and company. I would say everybody's name. I don't know them all. So thank you guys very much for everything you do to make Matt and I look and sound good, because we need it.
Well, if we want to build drama for this final 10.5 seconds,
it's working.
I think we've established that.
It is working. I'm curious, how many songs are we going to get through? So I have a game at 9:45. If we play 12 more minutes, I'm not going to make it. How warm is it outside? Let's see. Oh, it warmed up. For all of you listening outside of Anchorage, I was going to wow you with our horrible temperatures, but it's actually not bad. It's 1 degree, so we're good.
Say one?
What, one?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it went up.
It's a heat wave.
Saw minus 10 earlier today as we were driving around finishing up our Christmas shopping, hopefully finishing up. Actually ran into Bruce Check at Fifth Avenue Mall.
I'm not going to make any jokes as a one-time off-ice official. I was just a penalty box attendant, but there's some pressure in and of itself because you want to make sure you open the door at just the right time or stay out of the way of the opposing player. And, you know, there's something to be said for that. All right, looks like we got something almost right.
We're close.
There we go.
Close. All right. Now both teams are extremely well-rested as they had their third intermission. And we'll play our last 10 and a half seconds. And we have a whistle. Okay, here we go. Off the draw. Back to the point it goes. Bamber fumbles it into the corner. And that's pretty much going to do it for this one. The puck's just going to die right there on the half wall. And it is over. 1-0. UAF takes not only the win tonight, but they also wrap up the 22-23 Alaska Airlines Governor's Cup. So the final two games of this series in a couple of weeks are really just going to be more for pride than anything else.
Yeah, I mean, you know, like we've talked a couple times, these teams, again, whether this rivalry is what it is, and Fairbanks is going to be really happy winning the Governor's Cup again. As we well know, they don't waste any time being proud of it, which is perfectly fine, but the realism of what this world is in Division I hockey in Alaska is these teams need to exist, both of them. They need to be healthy. They need to be as happy as possible. One's going to rely on the other, whether they like it or not, whether the fans for either squad like it or not. So,
you know, when I was talking with Bruce earlier, it was pretty simple consensus that, you know, when we're not playing each other, UAA and UAF cheer for each other because, like you just said, we have to be successful. And the more success Fairbanks has, the more success Anchorage has, that's just going to make the programs that much stronger. And, you know, we want to see Fairbanks win every time they're not playing against UAA. So, and hopefully the Fairbanks fans realize that as well.
And a night like tonight should go a long way towards saying, okay, because all the cards, let's just be realistic, all the cards are stacked mightily against UAA.
Yeah.
A team with a zillion freshmen, full of guys who, you know, really never ate, who have played at programs but never played these minutes before, never played on special teams before. So this idea that UAA was going to be some kind of juggernaut at any point of the season is just a fool's errand by any stretch. So, again, all the credit goes to UAF. They well earned what they earned, and they take absolutely nothing away from it. But, you know, if you're UAA, at least you put on a better show tonight and showed, you know, some defensive zone responsibility that you didn't show on Friday. So take that for what it's worth. I mean, like, it just shows they're in a different day and age. Back when this was going to Salt Arena, there'd be a huge Stanley Cup-like celebration going on.
Yeah.
The ice right now. And it doesn't appear like we're getting anything remotely close to that. Because I'm going to ask a question. Is the Governor's Cup even here?
I'm guessing no. It wasn't handed out. So
the actual Governor's Cup probably just stayed up at the Carlson Center or wherever it might be up there. So. Again, but this was a better game. It was fun to watch. It had some real defensive responsibility. Again, isn't the sexiest thing in the world, but both teams proved it. Their ability to support one another when you're just breaking out of your zone and you know you have that help. I mean, that shows that from night A to night B, your willingness to do that shows that you're into it, that you're dedicated to it. So.
Yeah, absolutely. And like you said, the youth of the team, 11 of the 19 players on the roster tonight are either freshmen or sophomores.
Right.
So, you know, right now what you're looking at is potential and growth. Give it 2 years, and then we're looking at a lot more than just potential and growth.
And whether Matt Shazby knows it or not, we're going to give him a holiday gift and let him off the hook and not to talk to them. But, again, I just want to commend them for making a better effort from night one to night two. Still a long way to go. I just hope the people that want to be fans, want this program to thrive and be around for a while, understand these aren't the same lumps as they were 5 years ago, 10 years ago.
Exactly.
These are brand-new, different, real world of college hockey lumps that this program is taking right now. And we just have to have some,
you know, the thing is,
some level of faith that something good's going to come out of this.
Definitely,
someday.
Definitely. And any team facing a situation like UAA is trying to piece together a roster in very short order. You could expect to suffer the same kind of lumps. That's just the way it is.
And
you don't go out.
These are all hockey dudes, so they're going to say the same thing. We need to do this. We need to do that. We're dumbfounded that we're unable. We can only get four shots off in the third period.
I get that too. I understand how these guys tick, and you know, they have a little time of the holiday break before they head out to Massachusetts.
Yep.
And you know, just small baby steps. Keep trying to find those baby steps.
Yeah, there's a lot of good teams still on the schedule, and definitely some winnable games still on the schedule. So, you know, there's absolutely zero panic in this team and in the coaching staff, and there shouldn't be, because it's about growing.
Yeah.
And, you know,
I'm
moving from juniors to college, that's an adjustment for anyone.
I'm just as eager as anybody else to see what this looks like.
Absolutely.
And again, there might not be a lot of goals. It might not be a lot of wins, but it's got its own kind of entertainment value. Whether that sounds silly or not, I don't know. But that, you know, that's just kind of the way I see it. And I just want to live in a state with college hockey. I'll be really honest about that.
Absolutely.
My whole life's been consumed by being around the minor league and the Division I game. I don't know any other thing but this. So we as a community have to find a way to support it, win, lose, or draw.
Absolutely. You know what? Let's leave.
I know. Happy holidays.
Happy holidays to everybody. Thanks for tuning in. And we appreciate it. We'll do this again sometime in January when we play at Fairbanks.
The 27th, I believe.
Something
January.
Like that. Let's look at the wall. It says.
That is what it is. Yes, it is January 27th.
Good call. Good call. All right. Merry Christmas. Happy holidays, everyone. Thanks for tuning in. See you next year.